Observe what happens during a lunar eclipse. Now, a lunar eclipse happens when the Earth casts a shadow on the moon.
But every now and then cast a shadow on the moon. And when it did, that shadow was always round. Now, the only shape we know of that always casts a round shadow is a ball.
What's happening in that case is that the sun is on one side of the Earth. The Earth is in the middle. And it's casting a shadow. The Earth is casting a shadow on the moon. And as the shadow moves across the moon, you'll notice that the shadow is curved. It's round. The only shape that can cast a shadow that's curved from any direction you put the light is a sphere.
Now take a look at this time lapse of this moon, where both the sun, again, this is the sunrise, the sun and the moon are both above the horizon. Look at the top portion of the moon. It's darkened. Again, going back, put pause here for a second, going back to this model, the top portion should be illuminated, of course, and the bottom portion darkened, and you're not getting that. You're getting the exact opposite. So this definitely proves this is not caused by the so-called ball Earth. See this? It's clear as day. For all those people saying the lunar eclipse debunks the flat Earth, you're completely wrong.
Thank you. Well, space fanatics, we've got some exciting news for you. Some of the craters and mountains on Pluto's largest moon, Charon, have been officially named. Up until July 2015, Pluto's largest moon, Charon, was just a pixel in terms of what we actually knew about it. Well, that all changed when NASA's New Horizons spacecraft set off through space to analyze the planet, revealing craters, deep crevices, valleys, and mountains on the distant moon, surface features that now have formal names. From a mountain named after Stanley Kubrick, to a crater named for Captain Nemo. Many of Charon's features now have been named for the literature mythology of exploration. While some of the names come from the IAU's Our Pluto campaign, where people from all around the world were given a chance to contribute their ideas, the International Astronomical Union said NASA's New Horizon team, which led the first exploration of Pluto and its moons in 2015, played an instrumental role in the name approval process. New Horizons came within 17,000 miles of Charon during its brief approach in 2015, changing what we know about it by several orders of magnitude. Reporting in New York, Trinity Chavez, RT.
One of the things you can see yourself with a pair of binoculars is if you actually go out to a lake and there are boats on that lake, the farther away a boat is, the more the bottom of the boat will disappear and you'll basically just see the mast of the boat. And as a boat goes farther and farther away, the last thing you will see is the very top of the mast of that boat. And that's because the boat is actually going over the horizon that's curved.
As ships sail away, they don't disappear all at once. No, first, the bottom will disappear. See, the bottom of the ship is gone. Now we can see midway up, and then the whole thing disappears.
So, look, no boat here, no boat, right? No boat. I'm zooming in, but all of a sudden, right there, there's a boat.
I'm going to
zoom all the way in on this boat. You're going to see this the whole hull. And then I'm going to zoom out, and that's equivalent to the boat going away. So now this boat's going away, and watch, it's going to disappear from the bottom up. Half the hull is gone. It goes all the way up to the window, and it goes, buries the boat, and then it disappears. And a glober would say, you know, it's gone over the horizon,
but it really hasn't.
It's just an optical, effect. Like, for example, if I walked around this hallway, right? This way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I walked around that hallway and you were standing right here and I gave you a super zoom telescope.
Yeah. Yeah.
Could you zoom in on me?
Yeah. You can't zoom in.
You couldn't. Right here, I flipped the hallway over. I'm over that hump. You zoom in, you're just going to zoom in on the floor here. And this is a physical horizon, but it's not a physical horizon we're seeing. We don't see a physical horizon. We see just the merging of the sky and the sea. And then if you have a super zoom camera, you can open that space and see.
All you need to do is take two digital thermometers, or any thermometers if you will, and get them to the exact same temperature together. Then what you want to do is put one of them in the direct moonlight, and then you want to put one of them under moon shade. So you can do this in a number of ways. This guy right here is using a couple of boxes to get this done, and he's putting the temperature gauge in the moon shade, and then he's also putting one in the moonlight. And then you want to go ahead and walk away for a while so that they can change temperature accordingly. Now, the interesting thing that happens here, which many people will be shocked to find out the result, the moon shade will be warmer than the direct moonlight. It's the exact opposite of the sun's light. You know how when you're in direct sunlight, it's warmer than when you're in the shade. The moon's light is the exact opposite. When you're in direct moonlight, it's cooler than when you are in the moon shade. So if you are to try this experiment yourself, you can usually see a couple degrees difference between the moon shade and the moonlight. This leads many of us to believe that the moon is emitting its own cool light.
Hello, my name is Jerry Rogers, and I'm a little podunk town north of here called Shallow Water, and we're going to do a moonlight test. The moonlight currently in the shade, I'm going to get a recording of somewhere around 40 degrees. And then we go over here to the moon light full on, and we've got 32.5, 33, somewhere right in that area. And you can go right back over here, around the 40.
Now, would that be because we're looking at incandescent light coming down right here? Or
if you want to go over there, I don't care.
it's the same either way.
It's either way. Apparently, the moon don't seem to matter.
Okay.
Just so as long as you can get the moon shadow like right here, and the shade of the moon.
So that's the shade. And the shade is 39 degrees.
And then you go to the moonlight, and you got 32.
32.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Or 33.
Is it more dramatic when it gets darker?
It seems to be more dramatic when the moon is fullest.
So the moon, like a full moon,
like the fullest
in a completely
moon,
dark night,
sometimes 12 degrees.
12 degrees. So
yep.
the more full the moon is, the cooler it is?
It seems to be.
It's a half moon right now.
Don't ask me why, because I don't know. But I know it works every time I've tried it, everywhere I've tried it. Don't matter if I'm at the ranch or in shallow water. Went over to my 85-year-old uncle's house and did it in his front yard, and he made me go buy him one.
Ready? 56. Machine read the letters. Good. 66. 57. 67, 66, 67, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, 66, Okay, now we're here, no moonlight, 72, 71, 72, 71, 72, 71, 71, 72, wow, it's way warmer in the shade. Let's hold on, we're gonna move it back. Let's change for a second, I'm not sure where the moonlight is. Let's just move it all in.
No, I can see the moonlight.
Where is it?
Because it's right around the shadow of the...
Down 56.
I'll do it all the way to the right.
64. 56. 55.
Most everybody.
60. 61. 55. 59. 62. 61. Now watch. Again. 71. This is freaking 70s. It's super warm in the shade. The shade is super warm. Wait, you ready? 55. Look at that crack. 55. It's not even full. Fifty-eight, sixty-six, fifty-seven, sixty-four, fifty-seven, sixty-seven, fifty-eight, sixty-eight, fifty-eight, fifty-seven, sixty-two, sixty-three, fifty-seven, sixty-eight.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, what I'm going to show you now, we have talked about, and many sharp-eyed viewers have known that this was an important thing about this clip for a long time. Here comes the wave. Look at the dark underlined crater in the center of your screen. Watch how it's displaced, almost like you're looking through water. There goes the wave backwards, forwards, the wave hits the crater, displaces. This wave is displacing, as if you are looking through water, the entire image of the moon. Now, I've never taken the time to animate this. I have talked about it. There it is, zoomed in. Now, this is running at 30%. And I'm going to zoom out. There goes the wave to the top. And there's going to be another wave coming in from the bottom. Now, I'm going to run this at 30%. So as the wave comes in, you can choose any landmark you want. Here comes the wave from the bottom to the top. Choose any little landmark you can see there and watch it be displaced. Now, that round-looking ring crater, forwards, backwards, forwards, backwards, and one more time forward, and I'll zoom out, and you can watch it go all the way to the top. Again, this is at 30% with quite a few filters like find edge and some other things, invert. Now, that means a lot. That means the entire image of the moon was displaced by this wave.
The pitcher, steroid Santa Claus, kicks and deals. It's a long fly ball going back, back. And the ball shatters the sky, bringing the ocean itself down into the stadium. Oh, Simpson just broke this dream's reality wide open.
Well, since I don't know what to trust anymore, I've gone back to this a lot, especially recently. I was born into a Catholic family, and this is actually my mother's Bible, but I keep going back to this that I, a year and a half ago, made fun of to my roommate, and then had to put my foot in my mouth because, I don't know, this could actually be a depiction of our Earth or something similar to it. But as you can see, there are waters above the firmament in this picture, and then it has firmament of the sky, which might allude to some type of liquid up here, maybe. But, of course, this is an illustration. So, I'm using this as my basis for now, because I've been pulled back to Christianity in so many different ways in the past few months.
Strangest places on the ocean's floor was only just discovered in the 1990s. And Mike DeGree is one of a handful of people to ever see it in person.
Without a doubt, one of the most amazing things that I have ever seen in the bottom of the ocean. It was while filming for Blue Planet. It was in the Gulf of Mexico. And I noticed there's something out in the distance. Couldn't tell exactly what, but it looked like a dark band. And as we approached it, the dark band became a donut. I saw this donut. It was black in the center. What the heck is that? And so, as we get closer and closer to it, I noticed that the black band had what appeared to be kind of steam over it. And then I looked, and there was water lapping against the shoreline. This band was a ring of mussels. And inside the ring of mussels was a lake. And it's like, wait a minute. I'm already underwater. And we went out over the water in this lake and tried to descend it and bounced off. It was so super saline and dense that the submarine couldn't go down it. We literally bounced off, and as we bounced off, we sent ripples heading back to the shoreline. It was insane. I've never seen anything like it.
This is a drone I put up. Super cold day, super clear, unbelievably clear day. And the sun was up here, and if the Earth was rotating, the sun in 5 minutes' time went from all the way up here, it went down, down, down. If the Earth was rotating, it would just keep on going. But what happened was, it went down, 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 and then it stopped. And it sat there for 10 minutes. It just sat there. It never went below this line. This is super sped up. And then instead of going down, it just faded away because the sun couldn't even push through. Here it goes again, right? It just faded out. It's still there, but its light can no longer push through.
Once we come down to the ocean floor, we get to what we call an abyssal plain. So this area in here would be the abyssal plain. The abyssal plain is the actual bottom of the ocean for the most part. It is the deepest part of the ocean anywhere. The flattest part of the ocean, excuse me. Not necessarily the deepest, but it's the flattest place on Earth. We got continental shelf, continental slope. We have submarine canyon. We have deep sea trench. We have abyssal plains over here and over here, flattest places on Earth. So we're going to summarize our lesson by looking at these different parts of the map here and try to find some of the features. We're going to start out down here at the tip of South America because it's got such a nice continental shelf sticking out here. And then we can see the colors very clearly graduated. So we've got a continental shelf, and then we can see this area here where it slowly gets darker and darker. That would be our continental slope, dropping down into a nice large abyssal plain here. Okay, a nice large abyssal plain. And if you look at this map, there are quite a few areas where we got some huge areas of abyssal plain. Okay, abyssal plain areas here and here and here and around here. And these abyssal plains can be right parallel right along the mid-ocean ridge.